Voting ends in just 3 days in the most tumultuous election of our lives. I'm Michael Smerconish in Philadelphia. This year's polls indicate the president is about to be sent packing, perhaps bigly. Remember, the national polling wasn't far off in 2016. They had Hillary Clinton winning by 3.2%. She won the popular vote by 2.1%. What pollsters did notoriously miss was the narrow margin in several swing states, which gave Trump his victory. You'll meet a guest in a moment who was an outlier and had it right. As Politico puts it, Robert Cahaly, a Republican pollster with the Trafalgar Group, had pre-election surveys that showed Trump nudging out Clinton in Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Florida, and North Carolina, all of which he won. Trafalgar also accurately predicted that Trump would win the Electoral College 306 to 232, though mistakenly they gave Trump the 10 votes of New Hampshire and Nevada instead of Wisconsin's. Still, Trafalgar said 306, Trump won 306. Then, in the 2018 midterms in Florida, Trafalgar was the only polling firm to correctly show Ron DeSantis winning the governor's race and Rick Scott winning the Senate race. As Real Clear Politics put it, Trafalgar also correctly predicted Senate outcomes in Missouri, Montana, North Dakota, Texas, and West Virginia, making it the most accurate pollster of the cycle among those firms that polled multiple Senate and governor's races. They're certainly not infallible. Trafalgar didn't think that Kyrsten Sinema would defeat Martha McSally in Arizona and wildly overestimated Brian Kemp's margin of victory in Georgia. But the Trafalgar Group is again predicting a Trump victory, even though most other reputable pollsters predict a Biden victory, and even though many regard Trafalgar's methods as suspect. Currently, CNN has Biden already above the needed 270 and Trump with 163, and the rest of the states too close to call. Trafalgar, on the other hand, is saying 275 for Trump, 216 for Biden, 47 toss-up. Are they on to something? We're smoking something. Here's what Philip Bump of the Washington Post had to say about Cahaly on Dan Abrams' SiriusXM radio program yesterday.
The word I would use to describe his claims is laughable, from his claim about the sample size, which is absolutely ridiculous and statistically unsound, to his claims about the ways in which they do the polling, which are both unproven and subject to a lot of fluctuation that real pollsters try and avoid. I would say that someone who is trying to bank on having made a correct guess in one election is not necessarily someone who you should assume necessarily has a strong track record of success.
Similarly, Nate Silver of the 538 blog recently tweeted this: I don't know exactly what they're doing, but it's not a good sign that I always know what a Trafalgar Group poll is going to say without having to open the link. Well, let's find out exactly what they are doing and why they were among the only ones to get it right last time. Joining me now is chief pollster of the Trafalgar Group, Robert Cahaly. Robert, people want to know if you're the broken clock of pollsters. You know, you get it right twice a day by accident, or whether you know something. So how does your methodology differ from the rest?
Well, thanks, good to be here. Now, what I think you're finding is these guys are making pot shots, but clearly the fellow from the Washington Post hadn't done his research, because he said we got one election right. He didn't run through the statistic of 92.6 of the time our calls are right. That's a statistic that the Washington Post can get nowhere near in their polling. What they're pointing to is that they think that our methodology, because it's different, is wrong. And first of all, we believe that people aren't honest with pollsters. We don't think that's wrong. We think that's the modern world. It's called the social desirability bias. It's been around for a while. It was in play in 2016, shy Trump voters. You've heard this theory. And it was certainly in play in the governor's race in Florida last year. And that's why they all got it wrong again. So it's really great that they have such strong opinions, but you know, facts do matter. And if a broken clock is right twice a day, then you got to consider we've been right so many times that it's a group of different broken clocks, apparently.
So the social desirability issue that you explain, others call the Bradley effect. I remember that race back in the 1980s against George Duke Majan. You essentially say, look, people are lying. They're lying to pollsters. Well, then how are you able to get their real feelings and emotions where others cannot?
First and foremost, we do get greater sense of anonymity. The more anonymous someone is, the more honest they are. So the absolute worst way to poll these people is a live call where you have a live person asking someone whether they support Trump. Everybody in your audience, everyone you know, you can think of at least a few people that support Trump that don't want to share it with anybody. Now assume they get a polling call. You think they're saying they vote for Trump? Well, now just understand that that is a national effect and people are hesitant. Now, if they get a call that they feel like, hey, this is anonymous, I can make my feelings known, then you're much more likely to get a real answer. It's kind of like the social media account that you put your pictures of your family and your kids on, and then the one that people have that they kind of troll others on. That's their genuine emotion. But that's what's going to vote.
But Robert, some of the data that it's generating does seem fantastical. Here's something else that Nate Silver said. I'll put it up on the screen and allow you to respond to it. Silver said, I'm not a let's delve into the crosstabs guy, but some of the shit here is just crazy. Trump is not going to win 30% of the Democratic vote in Michigan. Biden is not going to win 25% of Republicans. Trump is not going to win independents by 32 points. Isn't he right? Those are your crosstabs, and Trump is not going to win 30% of that Democratic vote.
First of all, Nate Silver doesn't understand the way Michigan works. Michigan is not a registration by party state. So the party registration is based on the local primary you vote in. So let's say you live in Wayne County. Well, you probably vote in the Democrat primary if you want to have any say-so in county government, and yet you're voting for Trump. There's another person who is technically classed as Democrat who voted for Trump. Your party your lack of party registration means that your party is reflected by what local primaries you vote in. Everybody in America can relate to having to vote in a specific primary to participate at a local level while having different national feelings. And maybe if Nate understood the way the voter file worked, he'd see it differently.
Here's another one. And these are guys that speak your language. I hope this isn't going to be above the rest of it. David Wasserman from the Cook Political Report. David Wasserman, to me, the fact that Trafalgar is publishing ridiculous 60-person crosstabs of Pennsylvania's 18 districts is the biggest tell they don't really know what they're doing. What's your response to that?
I don't see how, if you add up all the crosstabs, you certainly get up, you get to the point where you have the full 1,000-person sample. I mean, they're attacking the sample size. So if, by their math, you'd rather go with the small 400, 500, 600 sample size, we have a minimum of 1,000. So we get a lower margin of error. So, you know, I'm sure there are lots of guys like that who spent, back in the day, were attacked, these Pony Express defenders who were attacking the telegraph lines, but they're going to be proven to be wrong again, and then we're going to see who knows what they're doing and who doesn't.
Pennsylvania, I'll put this on the screen. Let me show you where the CNN poll of polls is and where you are. You show it at 48.4 to 47.6, essentially a tie. CNN says it's a 7-point race. Let me move on to Wisconsin next. Wisconsin, huge outlier, 47.1 to 47.5. You've got Wisconsin by 9 for CNN has Wisconsin by 9 for Joe Biden. Wherein lies that disconnect? A 9-point race or a dead heat?
I like my record versus CNN polls in the last two cycles. I'll stand by that.
On Wednesday morning, you're either going to be someone with egg on his face or someone who I guess is, again, going to be able to say, I got it right. The charge is that you're in the tank for Trump. Respond to that.
Well, then explain why in 2018 we called quite a few races that the Republicans really wanted to win, like John James. I think John James is a great guy, but Debbie Stabenow is going to win, and we called that right better than anyone else. We dismissed the challenge against Joe Manchin in July as being ineffective and called the race for Manchin. We predicted Evers would defeat the Scott Walker in Wisconsin, and we also called that Tester would defeat Rosendale in Montana when all the Republicans wanted Rosendale to win. So why would I do that? I care more about getting it right. These guys make money serving a client. Our client, our only focus is getting it right because that's where our private sector business comes from. We're not pushing any media or paid political agenda. And we don't live by
I know
the click.
I know that it's not inexpensive to be in the field in all these battleground states? Who pays for the data that I've just shared with the CNN audience?
When we put a presidential poll, everything is on our social media. If we put a presidential poll out and we don't list a partner, then we pay for the presidential question ourselves. We quite often sell additional questions, as many pollsters do, but nobody pays for a presidential question we put out as our own. And when we put a poll out with a partner, that's made very clear in the post.